Take your Bibles this morning, if you would, go with me to the book of Jeremiah. If you wouldn't mind Jeremiah, we're going to be in chapter 4. As you're going there, let's all shout it out together. Lord, may the word change me. Nehemiah chapter 4, if you guys would go to the Old Testament. What?
You said Jeremiah?
Oh, Nehemiah. I don't know. It's been a long morning already. Nehemiah. Nehemiah chapter 4. I'm sorry. You don't have to laugh at me. Just correct me. I tell you, it's a rough crowd. It's a rough crowd. Nehemiah chapter 4. If you guys would go to Nehemiah chapter 4 with me. As you're going there, I want to just ask you a couple questions this morning. Will you remain faithful during these last days? Will you remain faithful? Nehemiah chapter 4, if you're there, shout amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's read this together. We're going to just bounce around a little bit. Verse number 1 would say this: But so it happened, when Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, that he was furious and very indignant, and he what?
Mocked
the Jews. There's always going to be a voice of mockery. Don't let it surprise you when it happens. Look at verse 3. Now Tobiah, the Ammonite, was beside him, and he said, Whatever they build, if even a fox goes upon it, he will break down their stone wall. So in verse 1 and 3, we see the opposition. We see the mockery here that's taking place. Look at verse 7. So now it happened, when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Ammonites, the Ashdodites, but it's a large group, when they all heard that the walls of Jerusalem were being restored and that the gaps were beginning to be closed, that they all what? Became very angry. And all of them conspired together. If there's ever unity in the world, it's when they are looking to come against the people of God. Come on, y'all can say amen louder on that one. If the world ever needs unity, the one thing that they will come together in is an attempt to silence the body of Christ. It's when the world proclaims we are inclusive to those except the ones who call themselves followers of Jesus. That's when the world begins to lie to you. We're an inclusive society. Well, if you're an inclusive society, that includes everybody. You can't single out the believer and say, well, we're inclusive. One lady said, I'm inclusive to everyone unless your beliefs come against mine, and then I'll make your life miserable. So they all got together, Tobiah, Sanballat, the Arabs, the Ammonites, Ashdodites, they all, and they became very angry. Verse 8, and all of them conspired together to come and attack Jerusalem and create confusion. Church, the world's job and their mandate is not only to hate, their mandate is not only to complain and start fights. They want to bring confusion to the body of Christ. And most of them have no idea that the enemy has put that mandate upon them. But they wanted to bring confusion. Nevertheless, we made our prayer to our God. Nevertheless, we made our prayer to our God. Now listen, it doesn't say here that we went to social media and we fought our battle through social media. It says, nevertheless, we made our prayer to our God. And because, I love this, and because of them, we set a watch against them day and night. Now listen, verse number 9 is where it kind of twists a little bit. They said, because of them, we've now set up a watch. In other words, we used their behavior as motivation to get us where we needed to get to. Sometimes instead of getting angry at everything, you've got to use it as motivation to get you where you need to get to. Because I can sure tell you as a preacher, as a pastor, sometimes you preach week after week after week and you wonder, what will it take to get people to move? Sometimes the pastor smiles when the world declares that the church needs to shut its doors because all of a sudden now the church is listening. Now they're up, and the preacher's thinking, man, I've been preaching this for months, but nobody's been listening. But since they're now coming against us, verse number 8 says, listen, and because of them, in other words, we heard them, we knew they were there, but we're going to use this as our motivation. How many of you know that the Bible says that God will take what the enemy meant for evil and God will turn it around for your good? You sometimes have to use what your adversary is doing as motivation. When your enemy comes stomping on your door, you can either run to a closet and hide, or you can get up and say to yourself, now I'm motivated to punch some devil in the face. Because of them, we have now set a watch against them. We've used their anger against them. They ran their mouth so much, now we know what their plan is, and we've used it to our motivation. Just making sure you guys are with me. We've used it to our advantage. Listen, the enemy's ignorance can be used to the church's advantage. That's what God does. God takes what the enemy, what the world means for evil, God turns it upside down and uses it for good. Then Judah said, listen now, the strength of the laborers is failing. Anybody tired? Nobody willing to admit it. Anybody get weary while doing good? The strength of the laborers is failing, and there is so much rubbish that we are not able to build the wall. You see, verse number 10 is where doubt creeps in. Verse number 10 is when you begin to look at the circumstances and begin to think to yourself, I don't know if I can remain faithful. Verse 10 is the part of the story where you begin to question whether you can finish the race or not. Verse 10 is the point where you begin to ask yourself, is it really worth it anymore? Come on, somebody. Verse 10 is that place where it says that the strength of the laborers were beginning to fail, and there was so much rubbish. Thank you, Holy Ghost. There was so much rubbish that we are not able to build the wall. You see, verse 10 is where you get out of the scripture. Now you're only looking at what's in front of you instead of walking by faith. Amen. Come on. You are now walking by what you see. We can't do it because the enemy is so loud. We can't do it because the governors are coming against us. We can't do it because so many miserable, hateful people are saying mean and nasty things. When you start seeing the rubbish of the wall, you'll always say we can't build it. You've got to walk by faith and not by sight. Amen. But when they saw that the laborers were beginning to fail, listen, when all you can see is the rubbish, you'll always doubt the promises of God. But when you know that the rubbish that you see will build a wall, you see, when you look at the destruction, you can't see the rubbish, you've got to see the wall. Come on, somebody. When you just look at a pile of wood, you can't see junk, you've got to see the completed next project. When you see the junk, then you're going to say to yourself, we're not able to build this wall. But if you can look at something that the world would call junk, but you see promise. Y'all going to make me preach this morning. When you're looking at what's in front of you. Thank you. Come on, Holy Ghost. When you see what's in front of you, you've got to see the promises of God and not the lies of the devil. What glasses are you looking through? What voices are you listening to? Come on, church. Because God's word is yes and amen. God's word for His children is you shall be above and not beneath. You shall be the head and not the tail. You are a winner and not a loser. Can somebody in this room shout amen? Can somebody help me preach this morning? I am above and not beneath. I am favored and not cursed. Come on, somebody. When you look at the rubbish, you're going to doubt God's promises. But when you see the rubbish, but yet you see a wall, you will not doubt the promises of your God. But trust me whenever I tell you this, verse 10 is where you will make a decision on which path you will travel in your life. Okay. There's a moment where you're going to begin to start to feel tired. There's a moment where the thought of receding, giving in, settles into your mind. There's a moment where you think to yourself, can I do this? Should I do this? I'm awful tired. I don't have the strength. I don't have the people. I don't have the resources. I'm not real sure what God... There's a moment where you begin to contemplate your next move. I don't know who's changing my sermon. Well, I know who's changing, but I don't know why. You have to make in a moment, there's a decision that will determine your outcome. Boy, somebody needs to listen to what I'm telling you. There's a decision that will determine your outcome. And Judah declared, we're getting real tired and all we can see is rubbish. When you get to that point, you're beginning to go left when you ought to be going right. You're seeing doubt instead of faith. You're seeing the bottom instead of the top. He didn't stop there. Verse 11, and our adversary said, they will neither know nor see anything until we come into their midst and kill them and cause, come on, yes, Holy Ghost, and cause the work to cease. Not only was Judah pronouncing what he was seeing with his eyes, he was telling everybody else the lie he was believing for the enemy himself. Come on, somebody. It doesn't help other believers when you begin to tell other believers the lies that you're believing within your own mind. Judah is now reminding the people, hey guys, I know you're tired, and don't forget, our enemies have told us they're going to kill us. Yeah. How does that help?
That's right.
When you are sitting at home, when you're going through life, and you begin to doubt the voice of God, and when the enemy is speaking to you that God's promises are now not relevant to your life, and all of a sudden you begin to doubt and have fear, and you're crippled under the accusations of the enemy. Listen, it's one thing for you to be there, but then you've got to call up your group and say to the group, hey guys, I'd love to have faith, but let me remind you what the devil said. Hey guys, I'd love to be in church this morning, but let me remind you what the world said. Guys, I'd love to still trust for a miracle, but you know what the doctor said? I'm not telling you to ignore reality, but I'm telling you to walk by faith and not by sight. Well, I tell you what, if I preach this 3 or 4 more times, it'll be good. Now, let me look at verse 12. And so it was, when the Jews who dwelt near them came, that they told us 10 times, from whatever place you turn, they'll be upon us. Kind of reminds me of like the story of Job. There's always somebody to give you bad news. Everybody can die, but listen, the devil will leave one person alive, and that one person will be the person to bring you the bad news. So Nehemiah said, well, therefore, I positioned men behind the lower parts of the wall at the openings, and I set people according to their families with their swords, their spears, and their bows. In other words, Nehemiah says, I've heard what you have said. I know what the enemy has proclaimed, but I know what my God's promises are. And therefore, instead of standing here saying things that won't amount to nothing, I've got to get myself up and walk by faith and not by sight. There's a day to reposition yourself. If you are not winning the battle, reposition yourself. Come on, Lord, help me do this. And I looked, verse 14, and arose and said to the nobles, to the leaders, to the rest of the people, do not be afraid. Somebody has got to quench the doubting voice immediately and rise up and say, whoa, 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 whoa. Do not be afraid. Don't become weary while doing good. Don't be afraid. Remember who?
The Lord.
The Lord. Not the Republican Party, not the Democrat Party, not the left and not the right. Remember the Lord. Man, I'm telling you, great and awesome. Now Nehemiah is listen, Judah, I heard what you said in praising the devil and how everybody's coming against it. But let me remind you all to listen to the Lord, for he is great. He is awesome. He is mighty. Don't forget God while you're doing. Don't forget God when you see the rubbish. Remember the Lord great and awesome, and fight for your brethren, for your sons, for your daughters, for your wives, for your houses. Sometimes you've got to be reminded of why you're doing what you're doing. Because when you give in to the battle, you're not just causing destruction upon yourself. You're also giving in on your children, on your grandchildren, on your nieces, on your nephews. Amen. When you give the devil an inch in your life and he takes a mile, it doesn't just affect you. It affects your spouse. It affects your children. It affects your job. It affects your neighbors. Amen. Your decision is not just about you when you belong to a family. Nehemiah, sometimes you need motivated. How many of you need motivated every once in a while? If you didn't raise your hand, you're going to repent later. Sometimes you need some motivation. And Nehemiah said, guys, listen, don't forget why you're doing this. Listen, you're fighting for your brethren. You're fighting for your sons and your daughters and your wives and your houses. Don't forget. You see, you know what this is? This is casting vision. Don't forget the purpose of what you're doing. Don't forget we're not just rebuilding a wall here for fun. Don't forget we're not just having church just for fun. We're not just calling prayer meetings for fun. We're not just praying and seeking God for revival for fun. This is not, we didn't just wake up and decide to do this because we had nothing else to do. No, we're doing this so our community can be saved. We're doing it so our community can be changed. We're doing it so your spouse can be changed, amen. So that your marriage can be saved. So that your rebellious children can come back into the kingdom of God. Remember why you're doing what you're doing, amen. And every moment that you think to yourself, I think I'm just going to stay home. I'm just going to give up. I'm just going to quit. Listen, you've got to remember what hangs in the balance. It's not just about you. It's about your family and about your children. Nehemiah stood up and said, guys, don't forget why you're doing what you're doing. In other words, Nehemiah was saying, let me remind you that if we don't rebuild this wall, you and your children and your home, it's all gone. Let me remind you, if we don't rebuild the kingdom of God on earth, your faith and your church and your freedom is all gone. I'm going to preach to the online crowd this morning because several of us have still got some rust on us this morning. Do you hear what I'm telling you? They want to take it away from you. They want to take the realities away from you. They want to take the freedoms away from you. There's a whole demographic of people, amen. But what they don't understand is in the kingdom of God is a remnant of people who have decided that they will not crumble. They will not bend. They will not bow. We will not serve the enemy, but we will stand. We will fight for our freedom. Sometimes you've got to be reminded of why you're building the wall. Sometimes times you've got to be reminded it's not just going to the church, amen. You come to this church to serve an almighty God who has radically saved and changed and redeemed your life. It's not just about a wall. Will you remain faithful to the kingdom? When you read Nehemiah, you've got to remember it's not just about a wall. It's not just about a wall. What this wall represents is freedom from your enemy. What Nehemiah's wall represented was safety, protection. What this wall represented was a future for our people. Will you remain faithful is the question. Man, whew. Will you remain faithful? I don't even know where I was at. Just let me start at 14. And I looked and arose, said to the nobles, to the leaders, to the rest of the people, don't be afraid. Remember the Lord, great and awesome. Do it for your brethren, your sons, your daughters, your wives, your houses. And so it happened that when our enemies heard, come on, when our enemies heard that it was known to us and that God had brought their plot to nothing, come on, that all of us returned to the wall, unity, everyone to his work. When our enemies heard, when the enemy heard, y'all hearing this now, when the enemy heard, come on, yes, Lord, when the enemy heard that it was known to us and that God had brought their plot to nothing, not Republican, God, that all of us returned to the wall, unity, everyone to his work. In other words, everybody had something to do. So it was from that time on that half of my servants worked at construction while the other half held spears, the shields, the bows, the armor, and the leaders. Now listen, look at this now. And the leaders were behind all of the house of Judah. And the leaders were behind all of the house of Judah. Now you can look at this in about 8 different ways. But I'm going to preach it to you like this morning. For too long, too much of the church has set back and said to themselves, well, whatever the leaders do, whatever the church leaders do is what I'll do. I'll follow, what's the old line? Follow the leader. But in this situation, you find out that there's a time that the leaders are to equip the body. You see, that's what leaders are to do. Leaders equip the body according to the book of Ephesians. And the body of Christ is supposed to take up their role of being the front line. And the leaders were what? Behind. And the leaders were behind all of the house of Judah. The people got together and decided that they were all going to fulfill their mandate. They realized they all had an assignment and they weren't, listen, there's a day where the people in the church understand that it's not just the pastor's job to get everything done, not just the elders, not just the deacons, but we all have got something to do. I'll move on. So it was from that time on that half the servants worked construction, the other half held spears, the shields, the bows, the armor, and the leaders were behind all of the house of Judah, those who built on the wall and those who carried burdens, loaded themselves. People who were already tired loaded themselves. Ooh, come on, Jesus. They loaded themselves so that with one hand they worked at construction And with the other hand, they held a weapon. Not only was everybody doing their part, they were pulling double duty. And they did not have the attitude, well, I'll only pull double duty if I get paid more. No, no, no. There's a wall here that we need to build. There's a country here that needs revival. And if we don't have the mentality, I'm going to do whatever's necessary to get revival, then we'll never get the wall built. Revival will never come. But if you will pull double duty sometimes and say to yourself to the church and really mean it, I'll do whatever is necessary. And if the church has got nothing for you to do, then you ought to be at your house on bended knees, finding your prayer closet, letting the Lord know that you are calling out the names of, for you see, no one can ever say, well, there's just nothing for me to do, when you step back and realize that you're standing in front of a bunch of rubbish. There's nothing for me to do really means I'm not going to do anything unless somebody tells me. It is quiet at the 10:30 service. There's nothing for me to do. It's one of the biggest lies the enemy has successfully creeped into the house of God, into the ears of the people of God. There's nothing for me to do. When there's nothing for you to do, then you need to get into the habit of every place your tires roll and every place your feet go, that you are praying and interceding. Amen. The blood of Jesus, the name of Jesus. How many of you know that we need some prayer going on in our nation right now? We need some prayer. 1 Corinthians 15 and 58, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, be immovable, abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain. Be steadfast, faithful. Who in this room this morning, who watching, will remain faithful? Will you remain faithful when it's not popular? Come on. Be steadfast, immovable. Now, I said all that to say this. Like when somebody tells you that, right? This week I shared the article, because now we know. Now we know. It feels good to know, doesn't it? I've been wondering to myself how many people the kingdom has lost since all this started, the last 6 months. And we shared it through social media this week. Barna finally put out the numbers this week that 1 out of 3, not 1 out of 10, not 1 out of 8. 1 out of 3 people who were attending pretty faithfully 6 months ago are now not attending, nor are they watching online. Wow. 1 out of 3. You can research that. Barna Group. It's on social media. So think about this. If you see 3 people, imagine that 6 months ago that all 3 of them were faithfully serving the Lord in the house, out of the house, being the ecclesia. And now, 1 out of 3 are no longer attending church nor watching online. I think, if I'm not mistaken, and I'm estimating, I think it was around 80-some that we counted last month. And when I say 80-some, some of that was individuals and some of that were families. 80-some contacts that we had yet to see since March. Will you remain faithful as you watch that 1 out of 3 people in the church has yet to come back? Not only are they not coming back, they are no longer attending services online. Yeah. Can I be blunt this morning? What that reveals to us, what that says to me, is that one out of three people that were sitting in a pew 6 months ago were lukewarm. We're not careful to know our own temperature because we're trying to find the temperature of so many other people. We're examining everybody else that we forget to examine ourselves. That so many people find it more comfortable to stay at home and now no longer watch online or come to church, because how many of you know that once you miss 1 week, once you miss another week, by the time you've missed six or seven of them, you don't even think about it anymore. It becomes very comfortable. It becomes very comfortable to not be in church. It becomes very comfortable to no longer give. It becomes very comfortable to no longer tune in. And the truth is, most of those one of three think they are perfectly fine. But the facts of the revelation would reveal that they are probably lukewarm. And how many of you know that the Bible says if you are lukewarm, it is no different than being totally cold, because God will spew you out and have nothing to do with you. One out of three have stopped attending church altogether. Some have legitimate reasons. Some do not. It's not a time to condemn people for missing. It's a time to run after them.
That's right.
As we continue forward, my question to you today is, will you remain faithful? Now, if you are in this room, if you are in this house, I have to already commend you for being here.
Yes.
And the truth is, you are already proving to be more faithful, maybe, than others. It's not a competition, but when the question is raised, will you remain faithful, it feels good to be in the house on that day.
Hallelujah. Yes. Hallelujah.
Will you remain faithful? How faithful have you been in the last 6 months? Is the Lord well pleased with you? Or how many have used the excuses that the world has given them to say, well, you know what? The world is right. I shouldn't go to church, so I'll just stay at home. And well, you know, it's probably true that the economy's a little bit of a mess, so it would be better for me to hold on to my tithe. And you know, it's easy to listen to the lies of the devil rather than listen to the truths of God's Word. It's easy to believe the lies because it's more comfortable. It allows you to stay at home and not go to church. It allows you to not be around people. It allows you to not be accountable. It allows you to not have to repent. And it allows you to not to have to give. When your walk with God becomes so comfortable that there's no more conviction, no, you know, I'll just make it simple. When your walk with God becomes so comfortable and ease that there's nothing to it, you're not serving God. You're serving God through the lies of the enemy. You're serving God through the lies that say, hey guys, we're looking at rubbish, instead of the voices that say, no, it's not rubbish, we're building a wall. Because I'm trying to tell you that serving the Lord is, I mean, it's not always easy. Will you remain faithful? Because I'm going to tell you, I have a feeling that we're going to have to go all through the rest of 2020 dealing with the stuff we're dealing with now. I'm not trying to get political, but I'm going to just tell you the truth. Most of this will continue until the election happens. And it will amaze you how much of stuff will change once the election is over. It's going to amaze you. And I'm not trying to get political. I'm just letting you know that I'm believing that we've got another couple months of this stuff. Get ready for it. They hate one person that much. So will you remain faithful when the enemy gets loud? Will you remain faithful in the middle of your storm? Will you remain faithful when those doors are closed? Because it's been revealed to me that a lot of people seemingly think that the only way they can serve God is to be in a church pew. My relationship is not built just upon being in this building. My relationship also happens the rest of the week, and I can pray and speak in tongues and shout, and I can do all that stuff. If your relationship is only built through God, through this building, then your relationship is shallow. Will you remain faithful when the doors of this building is shut? Will you remain faithful when they mock you? Will you remain faithful when they persecute you? Will you remain faithful when they ridicule your faith and tell you how foolish that is? When you keep praying against a virus and they keep shaming you and telling you how ignorant it is to believe that, number one, you won't get it, and number two, if you do, that God will heal you and you'll have no effect, and they're going to ridicule you.
Yeah. Yeah. That's right.
Will you remain faithful?
Amen. Yes.
Will you remain faithful on the good days as well as the bad? Will you remain faithful in those times where those who seem to be loyal suddenly abandon you?
Yeah.
Boy, that's happening a lot. Not only is one out of three not returning to the church, many of the one out of three are finding reasons to come against and to be mean, and they're just getting nasty. Having to find, all the time now, I'm having to find new ways to deal with nasty people and how to respond, but yet not come down to their level.
That's right.
Because some of them are educated and think their education puts them a level above you, but somehow you got to respond in ways to let them know that their level is not above you, and I will not respond the way that you respond because my level is a different level than what you are. I'm not trying to be mean about it. Will you remain faithful when you're standing in the middle of darkness waiting for a light to come on and you know you have no idea what time that light's going to come on? We're in that season right now. Will you remain faithful while witnessing, currently witnessing a great falling away? One in three, will you remain faithful? Had I asked you 6 months ago, look through the building and find those who you believe would not be faithful should the church have to shut down, you would be shocked at those who have disappeared without legitimate reason. Can't get a hold of them. Can't find them. They can't come to church. They refuse to come to church if you ask them to wear a mask.
Yeah.
They'll go other places with one.
Amen.
But they won't come to church.
Wow.
Rebellion.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm going to get myself in trouble. No need to come to church if it's supplied online. Which is also why I have told our media team we may or may not continue to be live. You want to feed the people who can't be here because there's legitimate reasons, but you don't want to enable those who could be here to sit at home when they should be in the house. Anger and excuses, and it just keeps going on. And I'm gonna pick on some of you here just a little bit. I did this in the 9 o'clock service. I may as well do it in 10:30. Make y'all feel equal. When I was a kid, I grew up largely under the pew. I chewed more chewing gum that belonged to other people. You'd be amazed as a kid how much gum was under those pews. And the music would be going, and as a small child, I was allowed to bring usually one of two things to church, a coloring book or some Hot Wheels. But if the Hot Wheels got out of control, then I would get a whipping when I got home. But there was you know, growing up, there was never, you know, it was like, you know, we're going to church. That's just how it was. And my mom and dad, you know, that didn't mean I was always perfect. But if I got out of line, my dad would let me know. My mom would let me know real quick. You know, with a point of a finger or just words, you know, just wait till we get home. And you knew for the rest of the service, you better sit down and shut up and keep yourself. And so I say all that to say to some of the younger parents, and I'm gonna hurt some feelings here, but stop telling the church you can't come to church because we aren't providing daycare for you. The more I hear that, the longer it'll take us to start it back up.
Amen.
I can't come to church because there's no child care. I'm going to move on. Some of you thinking I'm preaching on you. No, trust me, I've heard it 48 times. And those of you that think, oh man, he just blasted me. No, I've heard it 48 times from 48 different people. There's a lot of young families that aren't coming back yet because... Like, listen, don't let that be your reason to not come back to the house. Don't let that be your reason. And if that is a reason, listen, take shifts. Let mommy come at 9 and daddy come at 10:30. Take shifts. But it's also important for your children to be in the house of God, for them to know. Get your kids into the house. Come on, worship team. Will you remain faithful when the truth is no longer popular or accepted? Will you remain faithful when the truth is no longer popular? Do you know that I've been preaching since I was 16 years old? I am 43 right now. Look the same as I did when I was 17 years old. And I'm going to tell you something. Can I be honest with you? You guys think sometimes, you know, that he just preaches hard. He comes against us. I've never found a more difficult time in my life to lead and preach than we're in right now. You have no idea what it's like to try to lead and preach in the season that we're in right now. Yeah. It is more difficult than it's ever been. Yeah. More challenging than it's ever been. But will the preachers remain faithful in their preaching? Will you go ahead and preach it even though it's not popular? Will the elders remain faithful? Will the people of the church, who's going to remain faithful? Because if I tell you that all of this is going to continue until after the election, let's get together in December and see who made it through.
Amen.
Will you remain faithful whenever you're under strong demands to stop what you're doing? When family members tell you that you're being foolish and that you ought to stop going to church? When grandmas and grandpas and aunts and uncles, when in-laws tell you how foolish it is to be in church these days and how ridiculous it is? When your own family tells you you're murdering your children by taking them to church? Amen. Will you remain faithful? And you may say to yourself, well, preacher, nobody's going through that. No, 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 you haven't talked to everybody. Will you remain faithful when your own family condemns you, when your own family tells you that church isn't necessary, when your spouse is telling you that it's unnecessary? Will you remain faithful? When the world is telling you it's not necessary, when the world is telling you that it's no longer necessary, when the world is telling you that well, everybody else is essential, but church is optional. Your faith is optional. Will you remain faithful? Churches right now, it's 11:30 here. Churches in California are getting ready to open. Those who are deciding to go against the governor's demand, will you remain faithful?
Faithful.
Pastor, are you telling us to rebel everything? No, I'm not telling you to rebel everything. But I am telling you there is a Constitution of the United States of America. Listen, I am telling you that there's an unfair system that's telling you that everything else is essential. But they're telling you the only thing not essential is the Word of God and the Church of God. Will you remain faithful? And in the day when they come into a house and they try to shut it down and they try to lock the doors, maybe they shut the mouth of the preacher. Who else is going to be faithful in sharing the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ? Will you remain faithful in these last days? Because it should not just be the preacher preaching. It should be the house of God preaching right now. Will you remain faithful? I cannot find, I'm going to say this and we're going to worship. I could not find anywhere in my Bible where it says, "Well done, good and mediocre people." I cannot find in my Bible where it says, "Well done, good and lukewarm people." I cannot find where it says, "Well done, good and went to church whenever it was convenient for you people." I can find in the Word of God, Matthew 25, verses 21 and 23, where He says, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Faithful. Faithful. Constant, dedicated, devoted, loyal, steadfast, true, unmoving, immovable, faithful, well done, good and faithful. Will you remain faithful?